Hi, everybody. I am Joe.
I'm Derrick.
And I'm Matt.
And we are the host of
Beats, Balls, and Bourbon.
It is the official Groove Machine podcast for Loucity supporters. This is our fourth telecast, and we have gotten a lot of great feedback from everybody. We really appreciate everybody that's done that. Had a really cool thing happen where an individual came up to me that I had never met at the last game and said, you guys are doing a great job on that on the podcast, and that was kind of cool. Derrick, how are you, sir?
I'm doing great. How are you?
I'm doing fabulous. You look good.
Thanks.
You look a heck of a lot better than after the game on Saturday.
Yeah, it was
some thunderous action from you.
I was feeling pretty rough.
It was brutal.
I couldn't feel my fingers for a few days, you know.
Yeah, it was kind of crazy, Matt.
I'm finally rehydrated. I started being able to sweat again yesterday.
This is the kind of information. Yeah. It's the kind of information you get on this. Finding out that Matt was sweating.
Yeah.
And that's good. It's good to know. Sweating is important. Mm-hmm. You know that. It's the way that your body, you know, cools itself off. It's good information to have.
Yeah, that's somewhat wasn't really happening on Saturday.
There wasn't a whole lot of cool. No. So let's begin by thanking the folks that were on last week, Kenny Alward and Ken Luther and Lance McGarvey, who did a fantastic job. So we want to thank them. And we're looking forward to our three guests today. Brad Estes, the president of the team, is here. And Derrick, that's kind of cool that the president is kind enough to come on the show, don't you think?
It's always a pleasure to have a visit from the president.
It is. Mm-hmm. He's a pretty cool guy. I know he's listening, but I would say that anyway. I'm not trying to butter him up or anything. No, he really is a good guy. And then one of our capos, Matt Dalton, is here. He's already here. He's waving.
He's waving even though he's not on the camera.
If our camera could reach that far over. Yeah. And then something
we could. We're just not going to.
Yeah. not yet, though. And then Shana Farmer is here. We're going to start pushing the Angel Share stuff a lot because it's a really good thing. I know that they're talking about it on the other podcasts. And let's talk about the other podcasts just to mention them real quick, of course. We have Derby City Ultras. They took some weeks off, but apparently they did it again last week. Jordan apparently was a little bit under the weather.
Jay was kind enough to give us some valuable rat advice, I think.
Yeah, so we appreciate Jay Kirkman for doing that. And Barrel Proof, of course, on Tuesdays. We want to thank them for what they did. And then we have In the House, the Scouse's House podcast. They do a podcast. And then, of course, you have Howie, Lance, and Kevin Kernan on Saturday mornings on 790.
Of course, this week, Evan cheated on Andy with a different Andy. So I don't know if there's some kind of rift there.
That's not nice to do.
No.
There's rules. Cheating's bad.
I think. It is.
Mm-hmm. And then you have us. And like we said, we do not do any heavy content as far as technical game analysis. We're going to do that. We're going to do our version of it in about a minute. You know, we're looking forward to having our guests come on and do their spiel and talk and all that good stuff. So are we ready to move on?
I'm ready to move on.
Are you ready to move on?
Let's move.
Like to add?
Let's move.
So, as you know, we do our game recaps a little differently. We do a little poetry for you. Uncle Luigi is in a little bit of trouble. I don't know if you guys heard this.
Oh, no. What happened?
Uncle Luigi. Well, I'm going to read it about right here, but he did Uncle Luigi stuff. So, and we will include the game coverage and in our very special way this week. So here we go. This is a letter from him. It says, "Hello, dear nephew. It's your Uncle Luigi again from D-Block. I hope that you and the boys are doing well. And sadly, I think that you all have surmised by now that I'm unfortunately writing to you guys from a jail cell."
Oh, no.
It's not good. I just needed to go to the bank. I wasn't looking for this disgrace. But there were facts that the cops could not discount, that the money I was trying to withdraw from the place wasn't exactly from my account. You can't do that. There's
no, you really can't. It turns out
so here
they don't like that. They
frown upon
that. Yeah, they do.
So here I now sit, and I know it's my fault. And at least I have no reason to pout or cry. That is, unless I dwell on the unfortunate events that transpired on the 20th of July.
Ooh.
Now, our opponent that day was that team there from Bethlehem. At least that's what it says in their name. Because their stadium out there didn't have any lights. So now they play close to Philly. You ever been to Philly?
No.
Trust me.
Intentionally.
This is a freaking shame. If you ever been to Philly. With that cheesesteak screwed out. And as well as, we all learned when we was little, Bethlehem is that place where little baby Jesus was born in a manger. And then these three wise men rode smelly camels through the desert to go see them. Oh, if they were that smart, I should have driven there in an air-conditioned Ford Ranger.
That's a good point.
Thank you. And one of them had gold. Oh, who doesn't like that? The second had frankincense, that stuff that smells so fine. But the third one had something called myrrh. And I'm like, what the hell is that stuff? I would have sent his ass back out to get a couple of nice bottles of wine. But feel free to join in. I'm sorry.
I mean, myrrh, that's the stuff for when you die. So I was like, here, kid, hope you don't croak too soon.
Take that. But once again, I digress. Shouldn't be making fun of these guys because they trucked through the desert driving by their fear of sin. And I bet if they had a choice and had a chance to shoot 36 shots, regardless of what they were wearing, I bet they could have gotten one in. That's the depressing thing about you.
Too soon, man.
That's okay. Now, one thing good did happen. Me, Uncle Luigi, got a new celly. He's a songwriter called David Allen Moe. And he owes me a favor because I'm paying for his lawyer. And I told him my boys need help with the show. I said our team lost a game, and I am much too sad to put my feelings on paper for me to share. So since you are stuck with me and I'm footing the bill for you, I think you should do it for me. That's fair. So David Allen Moe put pen to paper, wrote this beautiful song about the sadness we experienced that extremely hot day. But also to remind us that we's here to the end. And there is many, many games left to play. So let's see what the song sounds like. This is David Allen Moe sent us a song. It was all that we could do to keep from frying. The sunshine, it was so ruthless, caused us pain. But Marauders, don't you worry about us parting. We just want you to win us all again. You don't have to call us to go to Slugger. And you don't have to tell us you're filled with pride. 'Cause we'll be there to sing, cheer, yell, and stagger through the door. Even when you're not the winning side. As long as they're Loucity, and we'll stand in the burning sun and the pouring rain. You don't have to worry about us parting. We just want you to win us all again. Now we saw a big old zero in the final scorebook.
Oh no, oh no.
And yeah, for sure, we was all a bit dismayed. But the only time we won't show, and I'm speaking for Derrick, Matt, and Joe, is when Jesus has his final judgment day. And we'll hang around as long as you're there, Loucity. And we'll be there in the pouring sun and the pouring rain. You don't have to worry about us parting. We just want you to win us all again. Okay, so Uncle Weegee said that David Allen Moe says that this is the perfect Louisville City supporter soccer song. And I'm saying it is not the perfect Louisville City soccer supporter song. Because it's missing certain elements, okay? Matt, what would you add?
Bourbon.
Bourbon would be something good. Derek?
Beer.
Beer? What else would you add?
Shots.
Shots? How about you?
Trains.
Trains. And of course,
bringing back Fonny.
Well, no, not getting drunk. So we kind of mixed the new verse together, and we're going to send it to David Allen Moe and said, we now have the perfect Louisville City Soccer supporter song. And it kind of goes a little bit like, a little like this. Just wait for the band. Well, we get drunk at city games because we like bourbon. And when we lose, we drink shots and beers to kill the pain. But we haven't done my favorite song in a while. I think we need it for good luck. It's the one with the gosh darn choo-choo train. And we'll hang around as long as you're there, Loucity. And we'll be there in the burning sun and the pouring rain. You don't have to worry about us parting. We just want you to win one, because when you don't, this ain't just much fun. We just want you to win a solid game. I don't know, man.
That's wonderful.
That David Allen Moe guy, he writes some pretty good music.
He's not bad, I gotta say.
So what do you think? Should we hire David Allen Moe for some more songs?
Yeah.
I think that's not a bad idea.
Absolutely.
So it was sunny, and it was hot, and we lost.
We did.
How do you feel about that?
That's soccer.
That's soccer, 95 degree weather. Man, I'll tell you what. We sat, our second half, we talked to, sat in Scouse's side. Man, those poor folks, because they had to deal with the sun. Like, we had shade. The second we marched down, we were done. They were stuck with the sun in their face the entire game. I mean, that is just brutal.
That is.
But I guess I don't know what place we're in. I think we're down there somewhere. Seventh.
Yeah, I think so.
So, anyway, hope you all like that song. That was a song. Now, for the people out east, that was a song parody of a guy called David Allen Coe. So, if you haven't heard that song yet, that was a little even if you have heard that song, it was probably a little confusing. I apologize. But did you like it, Shana? Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Glad that Shana liked it. Okay, so anyway, we're going to move on. We don't need to talk about that game ever again. And we're going to start it ever again. So we're going to start with our first guest. Our first guest is the president of the Louisville City FC soccer team. Really cool guy who is going to come on and very accessible. And I'm sure you all are going to enjoy seeing him here. Mr. Brad Estes, we're fine. Okay. I guess we'll have to give you a...
I need this for the...
You need those?
Okay. Okay. All right. But we'll tell you if you're loud.
Cheers, everybody.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for coming on. How are you after that loss?
That's a great question. So I wasn't really thinking about it anymore. Had a busy week at
Thanks
work.
Thanks for bringing that up. Yeah, right?
Exactly. Digging up bones, as they say. I'm doing well.
Good, man.
Doing well.
You look sunburned.
I've been playing a little golf this week on Monday with the players. Yeah.
Okay. Nice.
So what we usually do, the first thing we do is ask you, whoever's on, a little bit about themselves and what you did growing up. I know you played some college football, right?
Very briefly. Okay. Yeah. I got injured very early on and ended up leading the conference in shoulder surgeries.
Okay. Yeah. But if you could just tell us where you're from, blah, blah, blah. Everything up to the point where somebody asked you to become an employee of the team.
Wow, that's a lot. So I'm born and raised here in Louisville, Kentucky. I went to high school with my guy, Matt Owens.
Yeah, really?
I've known Matt for a long, long time. Okay. We actually grew up going to church together since, 5, 6 years old, something like that.
Yeah, yeah.
Wow. So I went to St. X High School, went to Marshall University, played I got my college paid for because of football. Didn't play a hell of a lot of football, but played with Randy Moss and Chad Pennington. Came back here.
Former Jet Chad Pennington.
That's right. That's right. Took you to the playoffs.
Yeah, took him to the playoffs. That's correct. Yeah. Now, what position did you play?
I was a tight end.
Okay.
I was a tight end, yeah. Worked in many different businesses, most of which would bore everybody to death. Ended up going to work for John Neese at Neese Ventures and had a lot of fun there. And he ended up making me an offer to come work for Loucity, and the rest is history, as I said.
And it's been, we're in the third year now, is that right?
Yeah, 2016, I came on in a kind of a consulting capacity. Okay. Been full-time for about 2 years now.
Okay, so 2016, you come on, you're not the president yet, obviously, but you're working for the team. Your initial, like your first week when you're working for the team, what was it like?
Chaotic. Startup business. And I feel like we're still in some ways a startup business. These business models evolve all the time. And so when I first arrived, what I saw, because I'd been through it before, I saw a lot of things that we could change to make things better. Mm-hmm. And that there were a lot of very young people that were doing some really good things, but just needed a little bit of leadership. You know, we put some framework around that, put some good administration around it, and we continue to get better as a business. We're certainly not where we need to be, but I guess looking back, what I would say I saw was potential.
Awesome. And when you transitioned to president 2017-ish, right?
It was about this time last year, actually. Okay, so about this time last year.
Okay. When you're asked to take on that kind of role, you have a lot on your shoulders. Mm-hmm. Okay. Prepared for it from other jobs, something that you're really excited about. Did you have any inhibition about it? How did it feel when somebody said, "Hey man, I want you to be the president of the team"?
I'll sum it up by saying this. A guy that I knew a long time ago, I won't go into how I knew him. He told me, "You've got to be comfortable being uncomfortable."
Hear that?
And so I've never been comfortable doing anything, because you're always trying to stretch yourself, right? You're always trying to do more, you're trying to do better. I would not say I was totally comfortable stepping in. Okay. And I think to some extent, if you're really comfortable doing what you're doing, you get complacent and you don't do a great job. So I was extremely excited about it, knew that there was a lot of things we could do for the city, had a lot of support from the fans. And so I knew there were all the key ingredients were there. And so I was totally excited and absolutely not comfortable.
Right. And then I have to assume that the first time you saw what the supporter experience is like in this game versus what you may have experienced with football, right? That must have been a bit of an eye-opener.
Absolutely. And that's the main reason that I fell in love with soccer to begin with. I didn't understand the game to begin with. But it's just a completely different atmosphere. It's a different experience. That's why going to a soccer match, I preach it every day, 10 times a day. Go to a soccer game, and I guarantee you will come back.
Right.
Yeah. We can see that you've got those soccer nerves on the sideline.
Yeah.
You've absolutely developed the soccer nerves.
Yeah.
I can see you pacing. I can see you sweating.
Yeah.
You know, not necessarily in the purple blazer for the last couple of weeks, but, you know, I get it. It's like, 130, 140 degrees.
To be fair, I wore it against Nashville. I did not wear it against Bethlehem. So I do feel like I played a little bit of a part in the 1-0 defeat. So I will wear it. I don't care if it's 140 degrees next game. I will have that blazer on.
I have
to get a line with ice packs.
There you go. Yeah. I have a hard enough time buttoning the thing. I can't put ice packs in there. There is no way.
I know your pain, because that was the end of the streak for me.
Yeah.
You know, to bum me out. And I was like, did I not sing good enough? I felt so bad.
You're like the national anthem Undertaker now.
Right. Yeah. So, that was crazy. But the one thing about soccer,
you saw what I did there.
In the lower division, soccer support is way different than, I don't know how many, if you've been to any MLS games yet, if you've done that.
Yeah, okay. Several.
And to me, it's a lot more organic, because there's something called, Sean Reynolds was on here a couple shows ago, and he said something that made a lot of sense. As our culture, we're all about wanting to hang out with the big kids. You know what it is? And we're not the big kids, quote unquote. We're second division. But to see the kind of passion that we've had over the last few years and how organic and how real it is, compared to that, you've been to MLS games, compare them. I mean, what do you see? Do you see big, legit, do you see big differences, no differences? Does it matter? You know, what is it?
How would I say this the right way? I know that what we have here at Louisville City, we built ourselves, and we built it one step at a time. We built it from the grassroots. I say we. I wasn't here to start the build. It was the fans and the ownership group and the staff and the coaches and the players. I'm not here to knock MLS. I'm not an MLS opponent. I do see in some instances where that is not built. It's thrust upon kind the market. Right? Yeah. It's just, you know, you go from 0 to 60 without warming up your engine. It's just a little different.
I will never go to a person who's an MLS fan, even though I don't follow the league and I've got my issues with it. I'll never go to somebody that has and be like, oh, you're dumb because you're an MLS fan. That's not right.
Right.
It's not fair. I'm not going
to. Especially to the extent that that's your town's team.
Exactly.
Because we always say club over league.
Right.
So that has to extend to that league as well. So if you're from Cincinnati or you're from Nashville next year, that's your team.
Right.
That's who you support.
So I'm just seeing that. And now you really engage in the experience because you come hang out with us, and I know I can tell you to a person how much that's appreciated. Because that's not the norm. You've done some work with soccer teams. I think that you would agree that there have been some people that are in executive positions that are a bit aloof, wouldn't you say?
For sure.
Right. So I don't know. Is that a business skill that you brought with you? Personality thing?
Like I said, you have to be comfortable being uncomfortable. I'm a man of quotes and analogies and all kinds of things like that. So I would also say that you have to know what you don't know, and humility is important. Okay. And so if I had stepped into this role thinking I knew everything there was to know about soccer, I would have failed in my role. So learning the fans, learning what makes it the culture tick was very important for me.
Cool.
And it also helps that I enjoy it.
Right.
I don't have to force myself to come out and hang out and have a beer with you guys because I enjoy it.
Right. Is it what something that you've learned that you didn't a skill that you didn't have maybe before you started this job that you learned through being in the position that you have right now, or something that you learned about yourself maybe? That you never even noticed it before, but now you really like, well, I do this or I don't do this or something like that.
That's a great question. I will say this: I've learned to be a little bit more diplomatic.
That's a good skill to have.
A little bit more diplomatic. When you have folks tweeting at you and saying, you know, singing David Allan Coe covers about the. I think I've learned a little bit of patience and learned how to be diplomatic a little bit more. I have a lot to work on in that regard, just because it's my nature. I'm a type A kind of person.
Right.
But I do think that I've learned how to be more reasonable in understanding other people's perspectives.
Right. Anything you want to ask?
I'm good right now.
Okay. Can I ask you something?
Absolutely.
If you were in a position of a leadership thing on a soccer team like you have been, and people engage you on a personal level, like you're talking about.
Mm-hmm.
How would you deal with it, or how does that make you feel?
Most soccer fans, from my experience, appreciate brutal honesty.
Okay.
And that's from, like, especially club level.
Mm-hmm.
Just tell them what's going on. Okay. They want to know. It's like they're part of a team. They want to be part of the team. They want to hear the bads and the goods. And, you know, when people come up and they ask you about the club, you just be honest with them.
Right.
That's all you got to do. I mean, that's how you earn respect in the soccer world.
And they might not like the answer, but as long as you give the answer with a straight face and the answer is the result of what you're talking about, sure.
Soccer fans are seasoned individuals.
Yeah.
We've seen the lowest of the lows and the highest of the highs.
And I can't imagine, going back to when we were younger, I can't imagine the 70s with Twitter.
Oh,
I can
tell you this. I wouldn't be in my position because no one would have ever hired me.
You know,
we had Twitter and YouTube when I was a kid.
Because, and that was, there was a lot of social, I want to use the word turmoil, but it kind of was turmoil coming out of Vietnam and everything that was going on. It was crazy. And I can't imagine what Twitter would have been like in 1976. I mean, it would have been insanity. So bumping against that.
It would have been hard, though, because they didn't have smartphones. So they would have had to hit every button three or four times.
Yeah, we'll get one of those Casio calculators. That would have been
hard, yeah.
So
though, I mean, see what we've got with Trump now. Think about what they would have been like with LBJ in the White
House. LBJ or Nixon?
Oh, man.
Nixon? Are you kidding?
LBJ was crazy, yeah. Believe it or not.
Right. So the Twitter thing comes along, and now you're reading it. You know, it's got to be a little bit of a toil, I would assume. Social media, being in your position, I mean, you're elevated. You're constantly in the spotlight. It's got to be a bit of a pain in the butt.
Not as often as you would think. Okay. I enjoy it. It's a good source of feedback. Every now and again, it gets a little bit, I would say, annoying, but it's not. It's part of the job, and you have to love every bit of it. And it's part of what I do. So.
And having gotten to know you, I know that you have no problem engaging with people at a gentlemanly level. So that's what that social media thing does. It takes that desire to want to be a decent person, because they don't have to look you in the eye.
Right.
You know, and it wears on me, because I try not to communicate with people like that. I really don't. So, okay, stadium. Everybody's asking us about stadium. Got any new anything? This building looks nice.
Do we have a new stadium?
No. Just kidding.
Yeah. The new stadium is coming along. It's coming along very well. And I'll knock on wood a little bit, because we've had pretty good weather lately. The folks at Messer are doing a great job. We're really proud of the effort that they're putting forth. They're down to about 140 people a day out there right now. They had as many as 200 people a day working on that site. The work they're doing is amazing. So right now what they're doing is they're excavating out the loose gravel that's on the field, so that they can start building the sub-air system in the root zone, and the pitch will go in September. The roof is just about complete. We have painting and then the bottom part of the roof to add. Suites have gone in, storefront glass is there, press box is in. Most of the block buildings have been built, but the innards have not been built yet. It's amazing.
People talk about the frame, and the frame is obviously such a big component of it. Putting electricity in a building like that is a massive undertaking. I mean, and the IT stuff that has to go in and all of that. I'm assuming that all the contractors have already been picked for that, and everything's ready to go. Everything that's all set to go.
All the contractors were picked a year ago.
Right. Yeah. Okay. Do you see? I don't want to ask any like really probing questions. We talked about the possibility of friendlies. Tim Malloy talked about that.
Yes.
Pretty exciting. Has to be, to think about other teams coming to play here.
Absolutely. And we talk about friendlies on many different levels. Right. Men's and women's national team friendlies, we're gonna shoot for those.
Awesome.
Of course, we want to play a big European or Mexican or South American team. We haven't gotten into the details on that yet, so we don't have any news report or anything to even to fake not report on.
but
we definitely, that's definitely gonna be something that we're looking to do next year. And we're already planning that. I met with Hack and Andrew DeLallo this week. Okay. So that we could start to think about when would we want to keep a week open for, awesome. For next week, next year.
I gotta assume with the facility too, we're being courted. I would assume that people are knocking on our door and saying, hey, it would be kind of nice to play there. Not just talking about friendlies, but I mean like schools, blah, 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 high school stuff. So I would assume with such a beautiful state-of-the-art thing going up that they're coming to reach out to you to find out what they can do.
I had a meeting last week with a group representing an HBCU to bring in a football game, really a festival around a football game weekend for an HBCU organization. I'm really excited about doing that. I think the timing will work out really well, and I think it'll be a really cool venue for it. It would involve music, and I think you guys really would enjoy that as well. So you're right. We are going to be the new coolest thing in town,
right?
And I think a lot of people are going to want to be a part of it.
And you stepped into something too that I was thinking about. It had nothing to do with us athletic events, concerts,
absolutely,
music events. Also, had my own experience. This venue would be absolutely perfect. And I don't want to scare people, because I say this and they're like, oh, they're going to destroy the pitch. It's not the case at all. But like a marching band or a drum corps contest, because they are always looking for sites that are perfectly, they have some of these shows in 40,000 seat stadiums and only 8,000 people, 6,000 people go.
And it reminds you of an Indy 11 game, huh?
Yeah. Well, yeah. You talk about Indy
11. Sorry, Ilya.
Yeah. Well, you talk about Indy 11. Lucas Oil is where they have world championships for the drum corps thing.
Okay.
And it is a massive revenue generator, because you're talking about 20 some odd organizations from all over the country, busing in the area, eating local food, bringing people to come watch it. So I guess that's beyond a little maybe what you're thinking, but you pretty much answered the question already, that you're looking at into things that are not just sporting events.
Absolutely. There's no question. Concerts. I mean, we hired AEG to be the stadium operator. They run the Yum Center. And one of the reasons we hired them is because they are active concert promoters. Okay, cool. And so they're already talking with several big names that you would know. Don't have anything closed, nothing scheduled yet, of course, but we think that we're going to be able to get some nice concerts in the summer. And you can't do too many, to your point about the pitch. I don't want I don't have too many concerts there because the pitch is
come first.
It's a soccer stadium, and we designed it to be a soccer stadium first and foremost. But we will definitely have other events.
And I would expect you all to hit up KHS AA and have the Kentucky, like the soccer state championship there, you know, so St. X can play in the stadium every year.
Yeah, we hope so. I'm an old St. X guy. Matter of fact, I got to give a proud dad moment here. My son, who just started playing soccer a year ago, he just got into it when I got into it, just found out today that he made the St. X soccer team.
Awesome.
Nice.
I was.
Is that like a varsity, junior varsity?
He's a freshman. He just got there. He's a freshman.
That's fantastic.
And I'm extremely proud of the young man for his work.
He will enjoy his four rings that he'll have in 4 years.
We hope.
Are they the state power?
St. X destroys everybody. It's ridiculous.
Our old high school, we were looking back, Kearney, they went one stretch in the 30s and 40s where they didn't lose for 7 years.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it's pretty crazy. And that's the other thing, too, that we were talking about when Katie Harper was here. The youth game has been big in this area for a long, long time. It's not like, you know, somebody's just going to snap, you know, somebody snapped a finger and all of a sudden it popped up. So I'm sure, like what Derrick was saying, they're also courting, or they would also just salivate at the possibility of playing in a beautiful facility like that.
We hope so. We hope mm-hmm. so. And while we haven't had specific conversations with them, it's things like that that we will be doing in that next level.
Right. And I would assume, too, with the conversations that are going on, you know, people have been talking. I'm sure there's been no conversations bringing a team in, but the NWSL thing. And if you talk about that potentially becoming something, then you've got the two professional teams. It becomes now you're managing how much abuse that field has taken and stuff
right.
like that too. So.
Yeah, that's what we would refer to as a good problem to have,
right.
if we had to manage the turf that much. Mm-hmm. But to be fair, we've built that so that with the sub-air system and the irrigation and the drainage, so that we can really, really manage the turf.
Awesome. Awesome. So I guess open microphone. I mean, you've done so much to help us out. And I mean that sincerely. I mean, it's not just because you're here. You have a ton of respect in this community. You've earned it above and beyond everything that you've done. Oh, wait, wasn't there some sort of award you were up for?
There was. Yeah.
Did you win it?
Are you going to ask me to? No, I didn't go.
You didn't go? Okay.
It was in Manchester, and the timing was hard. We were moving.
Okay.
And you had to be present to win. And
oh, I'm sorry.
I did not go. So I can say that that I would have won if I'd have been there. Let me talk about that for a second, because that was all about the team. And so the story behind that nomination was team loses coach, players coach the team, bring in a new coach, win the USL Cup.
Okay, okay.
And all the while, the stadium plans didn't falter.
Wow.
We got our stadium financed. We got our stadium under construction. And so if our team doesn't win the USL Cup, there's no nomination for that award.
I got you.
And I scored zero goals. I made
right.
no saves. So that really is all about the team.
Right. Okay. Okay, cool. I would give you an award if I had one.
Okay.
If I were sponsor a president of a soccer team in USL award, I'll make sure that you're nominated.
Well, that's awesome. I would sell for just another bourbon.
Bourbon. Yeah. So here it is. I mean, we record this, we save it. People will view it. Open mic. Talk about what you want to talk about. The things that you want the team people to know about. Positives. Wow. Things that you want to push. Go ahead.
Okay. So this is the definition of vague. So I guess I would say thanks to everybody that put in time and the effort to get the club here. To build the club from the ground up, to give us the chance to do what we're doing now. I think that anybody that was here at the very beginning, raise your hand if you were here at the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Would you have ever dreamt that we would have this stadium coming up out of the ground in that location?
No.
Of that beauty?
Especially after all of the promises of this pro team and that pro team and the other
right.
pro team.
So I guess my point is, we wouldn't have that if it wasn't for this fan base.
Okay.
We also wouldn't have it without the owners putting the money in and the coaches and the players the first few years winning. Because if they don't win early on, then maybe everybody falls asleep on the team and we're not here. Mm-hmm. Okay. And we're not there without the hard work of the front office. But we're certainly not there without the fan base.
Right.
So if you guys don't show up every week in the pouring rain or the sunshine or whatever you said before, David Allen Moe and Curly and whoever else was singing, without you guys, we wouldn't be here, and that's no joke. So I just really appreciate it.
And it's part of the reciprocity of the whole soccer thing is that the supporter culture, there's such a bond between the club and the supporters. It's completely like any other sport. I've never seen anything like it. I think you might agree with that now that you've experienced it, because I don't see anything. You don't see it in baseball. You see people fawning over the big stars. I mean, you see that, but you don't see them engaging with the people that aren't the big money ticket players like they do in soccer. You know, I really think it's special.
And it's also, I think, in a lot of sports, people root for the jersey.
Yeah.
Here, it seems like people develop relationships with the players.
Right.
And there's several players that have moved on to other teams. Sean Reynolds, Mark Anthony Kay, right. Kyle Smith, Greg, Cam, all of our fans, including me, I still follow all those guys, and I love all those guys. I trade text messages with them. So it's more than just, you know, the guys on the field earning a result for your team and getting free points. It's a relationship.
Okay.
It's very important.
And you have anything else that you want to ask?
I do not. I'm just glad you're here, Brad.
Thank you, buddy.
As am I. And thank you for everything that you're doing. I hope you had a good time.
I had a great time. You know, I really appreciate it.
Appreciate that you can back in the future when we have some grass or have some more news, you can come back on and you can tell us more about stuff, I guess.
Stuff and things.
We like stuff. We like hearing about stuff here.
It would be my pleasure. I really appreciate it.
Brad, thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen,
Brad Estes, president of Louisville City Soccer Club. Real honor to have him here.
And cheers, everybody.
By the way, I don't know if you know this, but every time we say your name on the show, we do toast.
Okay. Good.
So here's to Brad Estes.
Here's to me.
Here's to you. Thank you.
Yes, appreciate it.
Ladies and gentlemen, Brad Estes. We are lucky.
He's a good guy.
Yeah, he's a pretty good
guy. I like that guy.
And Matthew.
Are we rotating around or are we going to have the next person?
Oh, we'll talk a little bit. I think that you have been here since the beginning.
I have.
And to have not just Brad, but several other people who have been in ownership, who have been in management, who have been players, having the links that they have to us is pretty special.
No doubt. And I mean, I think it's something that doesn't get remarked on, but it's not something you see all the time in like a sports franchise. Like the president of the team is somebody here local. We didn't have to go out and find somebody. So he's already got the ties here to the community.
Right.
Ownership group, same deal. I mean, it's not like Chattanooga. Where'd the guy come from? Utah or somewhere?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. The supporters, we've got players who have come up through Louisville. Whether you got Paolo and Jeff D playing at the university. Whether you got Rich Ballard and Chris. Is it Chris? Is Hubbard the other one?
Hubbard played at Manual, didn't he?
Hubbard, yeah.
Sonny and Napo.
Sonny and Napo, right?
I didn't
know
Sonny. I knew Napo, yeah.
Yeah.
And that's the thing. Thank you. You know, I had a buddy of mine, and he wasn't saying it maliciously. This was going back about a month ago, roughly, maybe a little longer. But what do you get out of doing this? I was like, are you seriously asking me what mm-hmm. I get out of doing this? Even if I wasn't heavily engaged in doing like the drum thing or whatever. I've met a ton of great people.
Yeah.
And if you literally feel like you're being part of helping something turn into something good. And that mm-hmm. doesn't come along all the time. I mean, I don't know.
We wouldn't know each other if it wasn't for this team.
Yeah, that's
like crazy. we wouldn't have such great friends.
Yeah.
And it's like, you know, I look forward when we have home games. Right. I'm like, hey, I can't wait to see these people. Best. It's like every week, you know?
Right.
And in the summer, we have a giant 6-hour party every couple of weeks. That's kind of nice, too. So what do we get out of it? Cirrhosis, probably.
Cirrhosis, yeah. liver issues. But it's the truth. And you know, it's awesome to see people, not just like, you know, Tim was here.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we'll talk a little bit later about a couple other people that are going to be coming on that are part of the management group and work that are employees of the team. We had Evan here. He's an employee of the team. Great guy. It really, it's almost a cliche, but it is a family.
Mm-hmm.
And that's kind of special. You don't get that everywhere. We have all been part of something that we tried to start up that was maybe not a sports team, but it was a sports team maybe, but it failed, you know, and it hurts when it doesn't work. Mm-hmm. And this one, it's thriving. So Brad, thank you very much. I guess we're going to jump right in with the Angel Share stuff right now, right? Should we do that next? Shawnee, you want to come over? Ladies and gentlemen, somebody that has been, we want to talk about somebody that's been there from the beginning and done a ton of work. Shana Farmer is one of our bass drummers. Fantastic. You're fantastic. Yes, you are. And she's been a bass drummer, 3 years?
I think so, yeah.
3 years. But also, I want to bring her on, and she'll be fairly regular because something that's part and parcel with this whole community thing is that we have worked really hard. You've worked really hard along with some other people. You could talk about them. To reignite this whole community fundraising stuff. And I really think it's important that not just us, but hopefully the other podcasts as well start to push this a little bit more, because it really is something that can tie some bonds together. So first thing, Shana, I want to say thank you for doing that.
Oh, no problem.
But then, I mean,
I enjoy it.
First time you're on. So tell us about where you were at and what you did before you started coming to games.
Well, before I started coming to games, I moved here when I was 12. I've been an Army brat. My dad retired, and we moved here because it was halfway between my mom's home and my dad's home in Chicago.
Oh, okay.
So it was kind of like, and it was close to Fort Knox.
Jeez, that's true.
Yeah. Knew nothing about soccer until my daughter started playing in kindergarten.
Oh, okay.
And that happened because at the time I was with the police department. I was a detective, and one of my fellow detectives was coaching his daughter in soccer.
How long were you a detective? How long did you work for the police department?
I retired in 2006.
Okay, so it's been, you know,
cool.
Yeah. How long were you in retirement. Yeah. I was on the street in a uniform for 10 years. I actually.
And you put up with this?
Yeah.
If this was 10 years ago, I would have locked your asses up.
You don't know how glad I am. I don't carry cuffs.
That's awesome.
But you know, at the police department, for 4 years, 4 or 5 years, I was actually working in a neighborhood as a community organizer.
Okay.
You know, getting people together, trying to get them out of their house to combat crime and take back their neighborhood.
All right.
You know, and I learned so much about resources, because that was part of the job too, was to find resources to help the people in the community,
okay,
the kids, you know, whatever. And I learned so much. But then, you know, I was burning out. A friend recognized me. She's like, you need to come downtown and be a detective.
Okay.
There's an opening. You need to put in for it. So I did.
Uh-huh.
And that's what happened. And lo and behold, one of my partners, you know, I was looking for something for my young daughter to do.
Okay.
And he's like, well, you know, I coach my daughter's soccer team. You should come on out to J-Town.
Okay.
And I did. And my daughter played from kindergarten till her sophomore year in high school.
Mm-hmm.
And she even played for her high school team for a couple of years. And then suddenly she just said, Mom, this isn't fun anymore. I want to do something else. And I was like, that's okay too.
Yeah.
You know, and of course, then there was no soccer in my life.
Right.
And now
it's like, it's like a part of your life.
Right, you know? Right. You know, and then I retired from the police department and went to work for the Commonwealth Attorney's Office.
Wow, okay.
You know, so.
And you've been there now? That's where you are now, right?
Yeah.
And you've been there how many years?
Since 2006.
Jeez.
I know. But I just started in the grand jury about 3 years ago. So now I sort of have my life back.
Okay.
You know, so no staying late for trials and,
jeez,
you know, because one St. Patrick's Day party, I was actually in court 9 a.m. getting ready to testify.
Jeez.
And then as soon as they settled the penalty phase, I had to rush over to Ken's house.
For the parade.
I'd had like 3 hours sleep because the jury didn't come back till like 2:30 in the morning, Saturday morning. So, right. Yeah.
Bye, Brad.
But, you know, I saw this Loucity in the paper.
Okay.
About them trying to get a team, and then they got a team.
Right.
And they talked about selling tickets. So I think I got on the list.
All right.
You know, and to contact me when they started selling tickets.
Mm.
So, and the whole thing was to support a local team, something I thought we needed here as something to do.
Right.
For families to do, for everybody to do,
mm-hmm,
you know, because really there's limited amount of activities here, I still think.
Yeah, there should be more to do. I totally agree with that.
So that started it all, you know, and I met some, you know, at the time the Coopers had a message board, one of the old fashioned message boards.
Okay.
You know, I joined and I popped on there, and I think I met Jason Entz and Martin Mitch on there.
Sure.
And then Jason told me about the march.
Right.
So I came to a march, and it went from there.
And now I don't want to gloss over the bass drum stuff. And there's a time we can do that. We can do more of that. But I really want to talk about this Angel Share deal.
Yes.
Tell me, just tell everybody about it.
Well, you know, Angel Share has been a part of the Cooper since day one. Mm-hmm. Since they first, you know, I think became a thought. It's a big deal and has always been a great, you know, effort on Taylor Sorrell's part. He has always wanted the Angel Share Initiative to take off.
Okay, good.
It's been attempted in the past several years, but I don't think we were there yet.
Okay.
Kind of like how, you know, the front office started out with 9 employees.
And, right.
You know, the first year, I think the front office was overwhelmed by the response. The Coopers were overwhelmed by the response. And, you know, it was a gradual growth process.
Okay.
And then last year, Michelle Wilkins, you know, she was talking about it because the Luligans are, you know, the St. Louis people are outstanding.
They're fantastic. Fundraisers. They really are.
They really contribute so much to their community, mm-hmm. money-wise and donations. And she wanted to do that. We talked about it.
Okay.
You know, and I was on board because I thought it was, you know, I thought we could do it because what I'd learned in the past few years, we have people that have very big hearts.
Right. Yeah, we do.
And we have teams, players that have very big hearts.
Awesome.
It just seems to be the people that they recruit to play on our team.
Right.
That are very generous with their time and with donations and whatever.
Right.
So that's how it all started. And Michelle's like, well, if you'll do this, you know, you'll get on the board, you know, I'll help you do this.
Awesome. And she's really, really, she's done a tremendous job.
She really has. Yeah.
She's done a tremendous job.
She's taken it and run with it.
Yeah. That's great. Yeah. And are there any, there's Loucity ladies.
Though. Yeah.
Are they, they're also pretty involved in it as well now.
Yeah. Lily Matthews is a big help. She's been doing a lot.
She's awesome. I love Lily.
Lily is a
really great. Yes.
And as soon as class was over, like she's done a lot of running.
Okay.
Because, you know, class is out and she's, I've got time.
Good.
You know, a lot of the other ladies, they put their 2 cents worth in. Kathy Ryan, you know, she's always retweeting stuff, you know, sharing stuff on Facebook, which is so important, you know, and some of the others, you know, Liza's always the point of contact. Mm-hmm. She'll contact the charities and see if they've got a wish list.
Because
some people, you know, maybe they can't, you know, participate in an auction or a raffle.
Right.
But they can donate items.
So I was going to ask you, what are some of the charities that you all have run with and will continue to run with in the future?
Well, we're getting a list together. I think Michelle says right now there's a list of 15, which I will tell people, if you've got something in mind, you can send it to us at coopersangelshare@gmail.com or on social media, and we'll add it to the list. We do research on these charities. We're looking for small local charities. We really don't want to focus on any of the national charities because they get millions of dollars and money every year. They get federal grants. They get all kinds of stuff. We want maybe some of the small, lesser known charities, you know, because really us giving a large charity $1,000 really, you know, it's a drop in the bucket.
As opposed to somebody local that can really use it.
I mean, you know, when like, one of ours was Louisville Metro Animal Services, or actually friends of Metro Animal Services. I mean, they actually have a very small portion of Metro government's budget.
Okay.
And I think they actually had to release 3 employees due to the budget cuts. And they're always overcrowded with animals. So whatever we could do for them, monetary wise and donation wise, you know, helps.
Right.
You know, so, and that's what we're looking at.
Okay, and if people want to get involved and say take on, like you were just talking about, Lily, if somebody wanted to take on a bit of a leadership role, who could they reach out to?
They could reach out to me or Michelle. All they've got to do is shoot us a message on Twitter, Facebook.
And what's your Twitter handle?
ShaunaFarmer3.
ShaunaFarmer3. Okay, and then the Angel Share has its own.
Has its own.
Okay,
Twitter
yeah,
handle.
They do have
them. Yeah, okay. Yeah, and then of course it's coopersangelshare@gmail.com too.
Okay, and
so because I know a lot of people. They're not on Facebook any longer. They're not on Twitter any longer.
Right,
they've all, you know, pretty much stepped back from those drama social media things.
Me.
So, you know.
Yeah, and
if it wasn't for the team, I wouldn't be on Twitter.
I tell you, that is absolutely the truth. I mean, I don't even want to talk about it.
Yeah, anybody's welcome to join in. We're going to probably need more help next year than ever before.
Okay, and I was going to ask you what. Do you have anything? What's the next thing planned that's coming?
The next charity of the month is Louisville City Power Soccer.
Yeah. We went to that game yeah. When they played up in Indianapolis.
Which if you haven't heard of it. I had never heard of it until Michelle and I met with the team earlier this year. And it's for those people that are that use motorized wheelchairs. They actually have special wheelchairs that are outfitted to play soccer on a basketball court.
Right, right. It's very, very cool to see the people out there doing that. And they take it serious. They don't kid around.
They do. I mean,
they're into it.
And it's all ages. It's all ages. Right, right, it's right. All types of motorized wheelchairs, whether they're operated by breath, by a joystick, you know, however they're operated, these people, you know, they want you to join in. I think they're still looking for players.
Okay.
So, you know, reach out to them if you're interested.
Okay.
And the team did adopt them. That's why they are now called Louisville City Power Soccer.
Really? That's awesome. So that's mm-hmm. really cool. So I guess the last thing I want to ask is if a person had an idea, and I think you may have just said this, a person had an idea for a new fundraising effort in a new group, they should bring mm-hmm. that to you.
Mm-hmm.
You all, because I had somebody ask me about this, and you all will research it, make
that's
sure
correct.
That it's not, that, so you don't have to worry about, hey, I got to go, there's a club of some sort that you want to raise money for. And you don't just wantonly just run into that. And just,
no,
yeah, let's go raise
money. You want to make sure that they're a legitimate
right.
nonprofit.
Okay, good.
And that the, you know, ratio of their spending is correct, that they're not spending all their money on salaries and things like that.
Right.
We want that the majority of the money is spent actually providing a service.
Okay.
You know, and I'm all for the direct providing, you know, to an individual,
okay.
you know, doing right. actually something instead of the money going to, say, advertisement.
Okay. Anything you guys want to add? Any other questions? Anything?
We appreciate what you're doing.
Yeah.
It's awesome.
I appreciate what you're doing for that. I appreciate the fact that you bought a drum and are playing with it.
Yeah, it's fun.
I appreciate the fact that you help. You help. You're one of the people that, you know, you're such an integral part of this that I want you to know how much I know we all appreciate it. But
well, thank you.
How much a person
I enjoy would, it.
It's kind of it's really hard, you know, carrying around that 100-pound drum. It's got to be hard.
Oh yeah,
100-pound drum.
Well, you know,
monstrosity. Yeah.
But hey,
it's a 14-inch bass drum, people. You haven't seen it.
But it's filled with lead to just prove that she can do it. You know?
Oh,
but,
through one of our charity partners, I guess you made a new friend, didn't you?
Who? Oh, that's right.
Yeah.
I've been looking at adopting or getting a dog for quite a while now.
That's awesome.
And I will say this. Louisville Metro Animal Services has a program they call field trips.
Okay.
They occasionally have what they call field trip orientations. I went to one in April. What a field trip is, the training is like an hour at their West Manswick facility right now. And a field trip is where you schedule it ahead of time, you know, through the day on a weekend or whatever, and you go to the facility and they give you a dog. And you take that dog wherever. You take them to dog-friendly businesses. You take them to parks. You cannot let them off the leashes,
okay.
of course, but you take them and you give that dog a good time as you observe how they interact with people, how they interact with other animals. You know, you treat them to a cheeseburger or a pup cup or whatever, and they want you to devote your time to that dog. You can bring your kids. You can bring your family members. You can take it over to another relative's house. What they don't want is you taking it home if you have other animals, because
right.
they want that animal to be the center of your world
gotcha.
That
right.
time.
Gotcha.
I mean, you can even take them home for the night or a long weekend. You can take them and give them a bath, because believe me, they don't bathe the dogs that often.
Oh, okay.
You know, they don't have time, and there's too many dogs and not enough employees.
Gotcha.
So I went on this orientation. And I never took a dog out on a field trip because I knew that I would want to bring them all home. And I also had a cat, and I couldn't figure out how I could bring a dog home overnight. What was I going to do with the cat? And I didn't want to take a dog out for just a few hours, you know.
And cats can just be, the cats can be a wee bit territorial.
Yeah, they
just
can.
A little.
So I after I was on the field trip orientation, they encourage you to join their Facebook group for the field trip and fostering. So I joined the group, and one of the foster parents posted these photos of this dog, this pit bull.
Oh, okay.
And she gave this rave review and talked about how friendly he was. He loved people. He loved other dogs and he loved cats because she had three pit bulls and three cats.
Okay.
And there were no, and I commented with her back and forth for a while about the whole cat issue. And so we arranged a meet. Mm-hmm. And I actually went to Animal House and filled out an application and got it approved so I'd be prepared. And so we did a meet and greet at the feeders downtown.
Okay.
And the dog was everything she said. Mm-hmm. And because I told the people at work, I said, well, I'm going to go meet the dog. I said, to see if he likes me, because okay. I already like him. Well, that wasn't a problem. I knelt down to his and he was in my face and gave me a hug and pretty much washed my face, you know, kisses and stuff like that. Uh-huh. I saw him interact with a Great Dane, no problem. I saw him, you know, interact with an older individual, no problem. And I was like, okay. So last Thursday afternoon, I went and met at the Westmanslick, and I now have a rescue pit bull named Bobo, a 5-year-old blue-nosed pit bull.
Awesome.
And he loves people. If he were here, he would immediately greet all of you with kisses. He would insist, because that's what he did when I took him to work Friday.
Right,
and
right.
If he heard a new voice, he had to meet that person.
Right.
That's awesome.
Yeah. And I'm taking him to work tomorrow.
Oh, boy.
Because everybody fell in love with him.
Right.
So, yeah.
He brings my revenue.
Yeah. So I mean, yeah, what's wrong with that? You think they'll let me through? Because I will.
I'll get you a guest badge.
You know, I will. I've got a badge.
And that was one of the charities. You're saying it's one of the charities.
Louisville Metro Animal Services, yeah. And you know, it just happened.
It's a perfect example.
Perfect example
of making it better through.
Exactly. And I mean, and if your life situation doesn't permit you to have a dog full time, do the field trip thing. Join Louisville Metro Animal Services Facebook group or page and follow that, because they post the events. And I mean, it's an hour out of your time to learn about the field trip. And if it's not for you, it's not for you, but it's a way to get your, you know,
maybe find your own Bobo.
Enjoyment with well, that's it. If your life permits you to have a dog, but they also have a lot of, it's kitten season and they've got a lot of kittens. So
I wish I could have my complex when I allowed that pet.
I know. That's what I'm saying. Yeah, but you could go do the field trip.
Right, right, right.
You know, so.
So that's cool.
And I did talk to the representatives at Louisville Metro Animal Service that came out at this past tailgate. Unfortunately, the games this month, when they were supposed to bring out adoptable dogs.
So hot.
It was so hot. Yeah. I mean, it was impossible. So I told them, I said, well, next year, we'll either do it earlier in the season, like May, or much later in the season when it cools down. But I told him, I said, if the weather's nice and you know we're out here,
bring
some dogs by.
Yeah.
I said, I think most people like the dogs. I said, you never know when that connection's going to be made.
Right.
You know.
So, I mean, well, I want to thank you once again for doing all of this.
Thank you.
And what we'll do is either yourself or Michelle or anybody that wants to can call in every show and we'll try and dedicate 5 minutes to this and make sure that the word's getting out, whatever you're working on.
Well, they need to listen to Barrel Proof too, because we're actually going to have reps from the charities on Barrel Proof.
Awesome. Excellent. Excellent. So, well, thank you, Shana.
Thank you, Joe.
Thank you for coming and thank you for doing the bass drum thing and thank you for being a detective and Bobo's new friend and
Bobo's new mom.
Bobo's mom. And so, but thanks a lot. Really appreciate it. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, Shana Farmer. And Shana is special. Shana is a very good person. I'm glad that she's a part of this whole drum thing. And I'm glad that we have not just her, but a lot of other people, Derrick, that are willing to do a little extra.
That's right.
You know? So, well, it's time. I think it's time.
It's time?
It's time to do a week four.
And week we four. Have, oh, good Lord.
Now, right. We have somebody here that's going to help us out with this today. So, Matthew, if you'd like to come up here.
Come on, Dalt.
He's going to be one of our guests, but we asked him to come in here because I believe Matt Dalton is a bit of a wrestling aficionado. Is that true?
Seen a couple matches.
He's seen a couple of matches here and there.
That may or may not be a Macho Man tattoo.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, so you got a macho Randy Savage tattoo?
Yeah, yeah. And Jushin Thunder Liger, if you guys are into Japanese wrestling.
Nice.
Okay.
If you're that kind of nerd, that special kind of wrestling nerd.
Yeah. Okay.
Or the 10 years or so you wrestled in the States.
Is that true?
Yeah.
So let me explain what we do. We've had three. What we did is I pick three people that are Louisville City, either players, former players, whatever. And they've been matching them up with a wrestler. And then we take the three wrestlers and we have a triple threat match. And we script it out right here and we pick a winner.
Okay.
So far we've had Magnus Rasmussen, who was represented by Bret Hart. And then we had Niall McCabe, who was represented by the Demon.
Finn Balor.
Finn Balor. And then last week, Dobro, who was represented by the younger...
Cody Rhodes.
Cody Rhodes.
Yeah. So I can't remember the logic, but it was good logic.
Okay. It was good logic, though.
I can't remember. It was a lot of there, but it made sense.
You can go back and watch last week's. All of our podcasts, by the way, are on YouTube.
You should go back.
So you can go back and check them out.
Cody got the DQ win through Dustin.
No, it's triple threat. There's no DQ, so he just won from interference.
Oh, okay.
Ah,
got it.
Yeah. So now what we're going to do is we're going to have our fourth week.
Okay.
And we've got three people. And I'm going to name them. Now, you all sort of hash it out and decide what you think the person is who should be the wrestler that represents them. And this is going to be a little bit trickier this week because there's no current players.
Okay. No current players. Oh, you but sure?
Are you going to name other wrestlers?
We're going to name our current coach, though. Coach Hackworth.
Oh, God.
So we need a wrestler that sort of fits his persona. That you would be like, yeah, Coach Hackworth is sort of like this person. And then we're going to, you know, then we'll move on. So what do you think?
Mild-mannered.
Right.
Kind of quiet.
Sort of laid back, right?
Laid back.
But now he's like the brains get with the strategy.
Mm-hmm.
Really interesting to talk to. Not really a heel, otherwise I think I'm talking.
Yeah, Hackworth couldn't be a heel. He's like he's got that golden smile.
I've got the person if he was.
He has a subtle intensity to him too.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so there's that as well.
I don't want to give him a. I can't match him up with a wrestler. I could maybe match him up with a.
I can. He's a heel, but I'm gonna say it anyway. Bobby the Brain Heenan.
I mean, yeah, I would go there, but I just couldn't.
You see,
he was a great wrestler.
He was.
Yeah,
he was a diesel costume.
Yeah,
and he was a heel, but there was something about him. He was legit, though.
Yeah,
he wasn't just like some. There was the Jesse the Body Ventura type heel,
who's just the cartoonish heel for the sake of being a heel.
But Heenan, when Heenan talked, he was. I thought he had his.
He had a reason for why he was being heelish, and not everybody. He had a logic to it.
Yeah, what he was doing, you could see why he was doing it.
Exactly.
None of this has anything to do with Coach Hackworth, except. Even if you don't agree, I guess you can see what his strategy is in the game.
He would call out Hogan, and if you were a wrestling fan, like I was telling him, I checked out on wrestling when the Attitude Era started. I was like, I don't need. If I want to go watch porn, I'll go watch porn. And so I checked out, and I haven't been back since. But he would, you know, he would call out Hogan, but Hogan deserved to be called out.
Right. There's inherent sort of hypocrisy in a lot of these storylines, right?
Right.
He's just pointing them out.
So if you guys want to go with Bobby the Brain Heenan for Hackworth.
It's not great, but I don't have a good answer for
Hackworth. I was going to say Tully Blanchard. Another heel choice.
Okay, yeah, I like Tully. I do like Tully. That's a good answer.
Yes, but Arn Anderson? Is that
Who was the guy that used to announce with Tony Schiavone?
Mike Tenay.
Yeah, that's who I was. I could see him, but I couldn't.
The professor Mike Tenay.
Yeah. You know. I don't know. I want to take Heenan just because it's Heenan.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, the brain always gets presence.
Yeah.
Okay, so there you go. So Coach Hackworth has been associated with Bobby the Brain Heenan.
You're welcome, Coach. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, really.
I know he's a heel, but that's really, really high praise.
That's a high praise. That is. It really is. So now you have your current coach. So you have to go to the former coach, James O'Connor. Picking a wrestler or somebody for James O'Connor. Completely distinct personality, completely different than Hackworth. All right, way more energy, I don't, is the word nervous energy? Is that a fair word? Not nervous. What am I looking for? He's more overtly intense.
Keep going. Tell me more about what you think.
Intensity.
O'Connor.
Is this ASMR right now? Is this just that thing?
There's no telling. He's, very energetic, lot of passion. Over a lot of energy, not afraid to get in people's faces. That's for sure.
I know.
See, I have somebody that I'm not part of. I'm just asking. So go ahead.
No, I have somebody right off the bat.
Yeah,
the Iron Sheik, baby.
Okay.
Sheik, baby. That's a good.
Everything Joe just said.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's O'Connor.
Yeah. Except O'Connor could string a sentence together, and it makes sense.
And O'Connor would never have the Twitter feed. That's Sheik. That is the greatest Twitter feed on earth. He's unbelievable. He's unbelievable. You think
he got brain damage from wrestling? No, that's his personality.
So he really is something. But, you know, yeah. Unless I can't. Yeah. What do you think? Iron Sheik.
We're about to put the Iron Sheik in a ring with Bobby the Brain Heenan. And who knows who else?
That makes it even better. So what do you think? We go with that?
Yeah.
All right.
I have a better answer than Sheik. That's it.
Yeah. I'm trying to think of somebody smaller and was way more like sort of like a, maybe almost like a luchador type dude. But the fact that you're talking about putting the Iron Sheik in the ring.
Well, there's Bobby Hinton, but Coach isn't as crazy. No one's as crazy on earth as Hooven. Okay.
Yeah. All right. So there you go. That's number two. Now the third one, also going back in history. And I think he deserves to be a part of this because he was the first, he's one of that original group of people. That's Scotty Goodwin.
Oh, wow.
Okay. Scotty Goodwin, keeper. He was sort of in between. He's sort of like, I think of him as sort of in between Hackworth and O'Connor. But he's, you guys, whatever.
He's a baby face.
Right. That's what I was going to say. Absolutely. But there's no way he's a heel. There's no way.
Was good. So eventually someone else kind of took the reins and he kind of faded into the background. Went on to something bigger and better.
I have a name.
Kane. He's the freaking mayor of Knoxville.
Yep.
All right. Very smart. Yeah. He's a doctor. Yeah. He's going.
Kane is actually one of the smartest wrestlers.
And he was.
That dude's really intelligent.
And he was a doctor at one point.
Was he?
Dentist. Yeah.
Oh, Isaac. Right. Yeah.
CEO. I think that's a good pick. What do you think?
I'll take it.
Because I was the only one that I was going to throw out there was Lex Luger.
Oh, God.
Okay.
I mean, but I'm not a part of this. I want to stay out of it, but I think I like this because now you've got Bobby the Brain Heenan, the Iron Sheik, and Kane in a triple threat match. I mean, that's pretty amazing.
Yeah.
That is a pretty amazing triple threat match. So we have now that there it is. You got Kane. And you've got the Iron Sheik. Gosh, the Iron Sheik. I laugh when I think of him because of his, literally because of his Twitter feed. Because I follow him on Twitter. He is unbelievable. And Bobby the Brain Heenan. Okay, there's your triple threat match. Script it out.
I don't think that the Iron Sheik would ever make it out to the ring because he would shoot a never-ending promo backstage about how much he hates Hulk Hogan.
He wouldn't even make it out. They'd be wrestling. He'd still be out there. Mm-hmm. Oh my God, that's a good one.
Yeah. Bobby would outwit Kane at every turn and then get thrown into the third row because Kane is three of him.
I was thinking Heenan immediately under the ring.
Yeah, I can see that.
Right. And Hines, and let's two of them beat the hell out of each other.
The old Hornswoggle.
Okay.
Part of me thinks somehow Heenan wins it, but I mean, realistically, I think Kane wins that. Because even at his prime, I mean, Hogan pretty easily handled Sheik. And I mean, he was hulking up and he was Hogan, but
he took the title from, did he take the title from
Sheik?
No, Sheik took the title from
Bob Backlund.
Oh, God.
That was
a legend back in the day. Oof.
I think Sheik had took it from him like a day or two before or after I was born. Yeah. Random fact, yeah.
Okay, so you got Heenan hiding.
Yeah.
Ducking out. And you basically got Kane and
I mean Sheik's overmatched with Kane.
Yeah.
As good as he ever was, Kane completely overmatches him.
Just on power.
Yeah. Power, size, weight.
Because Sheik was a pretty good technical wrestler. Mm-hmm. I mean he was a wrestler,
He was a
straight up
Olympics.
Olympian. So is there any angle
where stood next to Kane. It is unreal how big that man is.
Really? Okay.
Are we going to get Big John Studd interference, maybe?
Big John Studd's already been
That was a good one, by the way, because we had him and Barry Windham. Mm-hmm. That was with
Hearts, I think.
No, with the Demon. Was it the Demon?
Oh, with Barry? Oh, mm-hmm. Maybe.
Yeah. That was a pretty good one.
Initially, when you said the Demon, I thought you guys were talking about the Kiss Demon.
Never.
No.
In our special main event, because
because of the contract, and we don't have
the dark match.
Our special main event stay on the card.
Mm-hmm. So they. So are we saying? Are we okay with Kane sort of like Kane, like Sheik does his best technically, but just in the end he just gets overpowered. And Bobby Heenan sneaks out from under the ring after not being a part of the match for a half hour.
And Kane crushes him.
I mean, I can see him breaking up the cover, like just clubbing Kane in the head.
Right, that's
stealing the pin. Because Bobby's a better wrestler than people think, and he's the kind of guy that would do it. So, if to me, it's down to Bobby or Kane.
Okay.
Bobby outthinks Sheik and Ken, and see, Kane outmuscles Sheik.
And if you're thinking about programming for a future four-way match,
mm-hmm.
there's no big power guy in the three that we have already. You've got Bret Hart. You've got Demon. And you've got the younger
Cody Rhodes.
So now I'm thinking you almost have to put Kane in there because you need a power guy in that match.
I think that's who wins it anyway.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
This is fantasy booking at its best.
That's the whole idea. Yep. So there you go.
So now what? We got a Fatal 4-Way coming
up.
Coming up
next week.
And I think we're going to do something a little different. If you want to tweet us, hashtag 3BPodcast. Let us know how you think this is going to turn out. We got Cody Rhodes, we got Kane, we got Bret the Hitman Hart, and we've got Finn Balor.
And we've got to remember that these guys are representing other Louisville players. For example, Balor is representing Nyama Kate,
mm-hmm.
and Rasmussen is represented by Hart, and Dobrovolski is represented
by Cody.
And then this week, it was Kane who's representing
Goodwin,
Scotty Goodwin.
Mm-hmm.
I like it.
All right.
Good job.
Done.
That's fun. I like doing that.
Yeah.
So there you go.
You didn't ask the one I was hoping you would ask. Oh, well. Another day.
Who'd you have in mind?
I'm not saying.
Okay. All right. Future content. Don't
yeah, the future content. Don't we don't want to. Because the way we're going to do this four-way is actually going to be a lot of fun. It really is. It's going to be pretty cool.
We got stipulations?
Yes.
Okay.
And right. We're going to have some
we don't know what they are yet.
We don't know. They don't see. That's the whole thing. They don't know what they are yet. And that's what's going to make it fun. All right. So there you go. That's our wrestling segment. Thank you guys for doing that. I hope you're having fun. I hope you like doing this.
I do.
Is this fun? That's kind of cool. All right, we're going to move on. We're going to move on because we still have a lot of show left. And I think
– we got some guy we got to interview, I think.
Yes, we got a guy. Who is it? Is he here? I think it's Matt. Would you like to be interviewed?
Oh, hello. Hold on. This guy. Okay.
Ladies and gentlemen, we've been wanting all of the capos. I keep saying capo. I can't help it.
You got to collect them all, man.
Capo.
Remember what Edna says, no capes.
Right. So Matt Dalton is someone that joined us a couple of years ago and has done yeoman's work in helping not just being on the scaffolding leading, but also now a heavily involved member in the ownership. The leadership of the Coopers. So welcome. How are you, sir?
I'm great. Thanks for having me on,
guys. It's a pleasure. I'm really looking forward to this because I mean, I've gotten to know you a little bit the last couple of years, but I don't know a lot about you from when you were younger.
I'm a man of mystery.
Yeah. So now we're going to unfurl the mystery. Tell us a little bit about yourself before you became a Loucity fan.
Let's see. So I've been a sports fan like my entire life.
Okay.
Right. I didn't really get into soccer until it was FIFA. If that's going to make me look bad, it's whatever. But it was FIFA. Right, that got me in, because I'd always sort of enjoyed it, but didn't really understand like the intricacies of it. Right, like some of the finer details, some of the rules, honestly. And it was FIFA 09. Was Ronaldinho on FIFA 09?
Probably.
It was like Ronaldinho and two other people, I think. But anyway, FIFA 09.
They're on 19 now, I think.
Right? Yeah.
Wow. Okay. So high school.
I went to Iroquois High School.
Okay.
South End.
And grew up here, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
So you get out of high school, you're going to college?
I went briefly to college, yes.
Okay. And it was, so you went on and did blah. What'd you do?
Man, it's random jobs around.
I did that too.
I've been in like IT, like mostly like hardware, like repair stuff for like 5 years now. So I've always been sort of good at it, but I've never really wanted to do it.
Sure.
Like I don't have a lot of passion for it, but it's always sort of come naturally to me. So yeah. So I kind of always knew I'd settle there.
Okay. And you come to your first Louisville City game win.
I came to the first match. I bought season tickets. My friend James Hicklin and I, shout out James Hicklin.
Okay.
We bought season tickets on a whim. I didn't know if the team would last. That's like a very Louisville thing, right? Like right. You don't, the Fire, the River Frogs, like the, all, right. all of these teams have been through here, but you never really know what's going to stick. I sat in the back. I had no idea what to expect. Right. And it was a show, right? It was amazing immediately. We scored a bunch of goals, but even aside from that, in the stands, it was unbelievable.
Right.
I mean, there's guys with megaphones, there's smoke, there's people singing. And to see that in a baseball stadium,
right,
where you can see people doing crossword puzzles and taking naps.
And taking naps.
That's yeah. In the same space, it's fantastic. There's nothing like it. I was hooked immediately.
And were you in the supporter section initially? Or? Mm-hmm. Okay.
Because they were the cheapest seats.
There you go. So over the course of a couple of years, you start to meet people, hang out with people. Mm-hmm. When is your first inkling happening where you're like, man, I need to get up on that podium and start doing stuff?
So I initially started pretty much in the back and just sort of moved my way up as the weeks went on. Mm-hmm. And I just started yelling a lot. And I think initially they wanted me up there so I'd shut up. So they could have me yelling towards the crowd instead of at them. Because every time there was a lull, I didn't like the silence, right? It just anything in between chants, I was like, here's my time.
Right?
Oh, and just screamed, right? It was during the second season, a little past the halfway mark. And it was Wyatt, actually. Who I had mentioned to him just sort of in passing, like, man, it'd be really cool to be up there. And he was like, you should do that.
Right.
And Melissa is who really made me want to do it, right?
Right.
She's the one that kind of like inspired me. Well, mm-hmm. Ken's okay, whatever.
Yeah, he's all
right. But Melissa, right?
Ken's a. And did you don't have any performance experience at all, do you? Right?
Absolutely not.
So, like I remember asking Wyatt the same thing. Might probably a little daunting from wanting to do it to that very first time you're now facing everybody and it's time to to sing into the microphone, if you will. What was that like?
Dude, it was terrifying. Absolutely terrifying.
It is.
This is a pee your pants moment. There's like what, a couple thousand people looking at you?
Right.
And you just got to do it, right? You got to hit the button and you got to yell. And hopefully they'll yell back and they won't immediately reject you. Because I'm normally a very reserved person.
You know, you're saying that. And I keep hearing people say that they're capos that were normally reserved people. Mm-hmm. So that's interesting to me that people, I don't know of anybody that I've met, maybe Ken. Maybe he's the only one, but even him, that were just overly extroverted,
mm-hmm.
you know? And you're saying that that's not your general...
No. I would agree with that sentiment. Okay. Absolutely.
So has doing this capo thing changed your personality?
Now? Absolutely.
It has?
Yeah.
Are you, like, obnoxious to talk to now?
I mean, you guys tell me.
Somebody's laughing.
My fiance's laughing right now.
Oh, your fiance. Please tell us about.
Yeah, we recently got engaged.
Congratulations.
Simone, off camera.
Simone, can't see her.
Just imagine her.
Did you all meet through Louisville City, or did you know each other before that? I never knew.
We dated in high school.
Okay.
And then took like a 10-year break and then met back up. I heard she was single and was like, what's up? And
she responded to that amazingly smooth, come on, right?
That, yeah.
Hey, what's up?
Yeah. And we've been dating for 3 years. Three and a half years now. And then that's awesome. I popped the question about a month ago.
Saw that. Congratulations
thank
to both
you,
of
thank
you.
Thank you very much. It is not something I saw myself doing, but I mean, she's the greatest. So.
Well, there you go.
Was it after Double or Nothing?
Yes.
Okay, that's what I thought.
I was actually going to do it then, like right after the show, but I was sweaty. It was.
You should have talked to Cody, man. Got in the ring.
I thought about that, but I wanted it to be more like more of an intimate moment, right? And I didn't know if like 15,000 people looking at you. Also, what if she wanted to say no? It's not pressure. All right.
Wow. That would have been nuts.
Talk about taking a bump.
So, right, right. And then also personality-wise, you're saying that you were introverted. Now, maybe not so much. Also, meeting new people.
Yeah.
Is that something that you may have maybe not have done a lot of beforehand, and this whole deal makes you sort of want to do that?
Yeah, it's absolutely the best part of everything. Like, me, I wouldn't have met you guys. I know,
right.
I'm echoing that sentiment from earlier, but I've met so many wonderful people that otherwise I never would have met. Because you're all there for like a shared interest, right? It's immediate icebreaker.
Right. And that's I keep asking this because I'm not an introverted person. And I've never been in it. Yeah, right?
The hell you say?
Seriously. You seem so quiet when you're singing songs about whatever. And I find it interesting that people use this as a vehicle or have been able to use this as a vehicle to literally change their personalities. Mm-hmm. And I think it's great. I never asked you this. Were you ever, were you introverted before this ever? You don't seem like a very introverted guy.
I was never introverted.
Okay, so... Matt, what about you?
I was the mascot in high school.
Okay, so there you go. did you wear the thing, though? Did you wear stuff over your head?
Well, yeah.
Because some of the mascots haven't taught band for all those years. That the mascot kids are usually not that extroverted. I mean, they'll do all the stuff with their costume on, but you take the costume off and they go run and put it away and you never see them until the next game or something. But anyway,
when I take the face paint off, I don't bang on the drum. Bring a little triangle.
But you said that and you've met a lot of people here. Have you built relationships with people outside of just say supporters? Have you gotten to know any of the owners? Have you gotten to know any players? I know some people that have become very close with players.
I'm still sort of in awe of all the players. I don't know. It's just something inside of me that's like, okay, you got, hey, I interviewed Niall on Barrel Proof, and I had all these questions, right? I did all this prep. I did I read his biography or whatever. And he walked in the room and I was like,
Right.
I like the way you kick. I don't know. My brain was coleslaw.
Do you like bread?
Bread's good, right? It was like the Chris Farley skits on Saturday Night Live.
How far away from Ireland is the UK?
Right. How many fingers do I have? I've met some people that have become really tight with players, and Sean was on here last month. He's one of the guys, and Niall strikes me as that type of kid too, where they don't let their for lack of a better word, celebrity, because locally they are. I mean, they are.
Yeah.
They don't let their celebrity impact who they are personally. And to me, that's one of the things that will endear me to somebody, is that they don't put themselves on a pedestal. Do you agree with that? I mean,
it's just, oh yeah, absolutely. You know, everyone, I've talked with George Davis at length. I mean, the dude is like, I always call him like the team stepdad. Like, he's always dressed very like straight laced and nice at all the events. But he's just a really nice guy.
I've run into George three times. He lives right down the street. I run into him at Lucky's.
Oh, what's his address?
Let's go do the podcast from his
apartment. I run into him at Lucky's.
Let's grab all our gear and let's just go over. Right, here we go.
Who are you calling?
That'd be
you only hit three numbers. That's weird.
So, you're pretty involved with Barrel Proof now, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, there's been a couple changes, right?
Recently. Yep.
Tell us about it.
We sort of solidified the lineup, right? Me, Ty Smith, and Glenn Grum. Eventually, they're going to figure out I don't know anything. And they're going to figure it out at some point.
That's why I'm hosting.
I was the most common host on that show for over a year. Yeah, they're not going to figure that out.
Yes.
Just commit to it. You're good.
Will there be any, I don't want to say changes, but I mean, what's your approach going to be? Are you looking to do any newer things with what you're doing with the podcast? Or,
well, I think the plan is sort of to let it come organically, because the three of us, like the power trio that we are, we're still sort of meshing too. Okay. I think every show I feel better about it after we record it. I really like the last show. Like I'm still getting comfortable with it. I know Ty is also, and so is Glenn. So I think we're going to develop our own style. Just sort of naturally.
Patrick's still engineering that? Mm-hmm. Oh, God bless him. Man, oh, man. I mean, he's got a He's just got married. He's got a kid on the way. Hello.
He's the backbone. He's the spinal cord.
Patrick Arkeberg is the man.
Yes, he is.
That's he
cheers,
is.
Cheers.
And that's what he's, Arkeberg. I mean, you know, Patrick, there you go. But that's for you. But that's really the godfather of the whole podcast thing. I mean, they've been around for a while. Okay. So now here we are. We're going into a new stadium. And I ask why, and I've asked all the capos the same thing. What do you think you'd like to see start happening what – I don't want to say changes, but additions, because I wouldn't change too much that we're doing right now. You know, I don't think we need to change a whole lot. But what would you what additions would you like to – first of all, you've written some great chants, by the
Thank
way.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
You really have. I mean, there's a couple of them. You were the one that sort of adapted the Scottish band. What the hell is that name?
Proclaimers.
Proclaimers, right? Okay. And then there's a couple others that you didn't you write the newer one to Butchertown? I don't want to tell everybody my name for that year. I hope you guys don't get mad at me when I do.
No, that. That's the official name as far as that's the canon name. Okay, two stars. Yeah, I did that one.
Okay, good. So it's great. That to me as a writer and musician, I love seeing. I love seeing people come in. And you're saying that it sounds like you didn't do a whole lot of that before.
No,
you know that's amazing. See, that's. There you go. That's pretty cool. So we're gonna get you to write our next song for the
like right now.
Yeah, come on, keep going.
So
what the game that hasn't happened yet.
Yeah, give us a general song.
We won.
Yeah, right. Let's see. So here we go. We're moving on. What's your vision?
So I think with safe standing, we're gonna be able to do a lot more stuff with movement.
Yes. Thank you.
Derrick and I have actually talked about this. He's got some stuff.
Yes, I know that.
Really, really excited for
it. Yes, I am as well.
We'll be able to leave maybe stuff hanging up. We'll be able to sort of make it our own instead of, you know, because we're running out the place now, right? So we've got to be mindful of all their advertisements, and their facilities, but it's ours now, right? And I'm really excited mainly to start making history there, right? So, yeah, start making memories. I want to be able to tell, you know, when I'm 80 or whatever, you know, 15-year-old kids, like, I was here when they opened this thing. My name's on that wall.
Right, right.
And they'll tell me, like, whatever, G-Paw, get out of here. Or whatever 15-year-olds call.
Right. But you touched on something that is super, super important. We live in an audio-visual society now. That changed in the late 70s. If you were in a band, like when I started gigging and we didn't, I don't want to make this too long. I refused to put makeup on in the early 80s. And all the metal bands were all putting makeup on. I'm like, the only way you're putting makeup on me is it because you have to embalm me. There's no makeup going on my face. And I was a cute kid. I mean, it was, you know, I had long hair. And,
I've seen pictures.
Yeah.
Adorable.
And
adorable.
That was kind of cute. But there was no way. And that was on me because it became audio visual.
Mm-hmm.
And you touched on something that's absolutely correct. What we do with cheers and stuff like that, and I know you were talking, and we've talked about, you know, a couple things that you want to do. It is audio visual. And the more audio visual it is, the more interactive it is, the better it's going to be. And it touches something on Matt, that you were talking about with being a little bit inhibited initially.
Mm-hmm.
People are going to have to break that even though they're not wanting to capo.
Yeah.
You know, and you know, how do you think? What do we do to make that happen? Not to put you on the spot or anything.
No, it's fine. Let me give you my 5-year plan.
Merchandise.
Hey, Matt, how are you gonna fix all of this?
Fix all of it.
Jeez, I feel like an idiot now.
So the question's like, how do we get people more involved? Is that?
So what do you think? Yeah, basically, how do you get them more involved in the newer environment? Because it's gonna be louder. Mm-hmm. It's going to be more intimate. It's going to be more visually stunning in general.
So next year, I think we have a golden opportunity, right? Because there's going to be a lot of people that are going to show up just to go to the stadium.
Right.
Right. And so for me, it's a grassroots thing, right? You need to walk up to people. You need to introduce yourself.
Right.
You need to say, hey, we're with the Coopers.
Right.
And just show them a good time, basically. Right.
Right.
It's this is how you build relationships. It's like person to person. You got to look them in the eyes. And show them, like, this is what you can do, right? People have to experience it in order to really get it.
Right, right, right.
And I know a lot of people have said it, but it takes one game. That's all it takes.
Yeah, and it takes one interaction. I make sure that I try to meet new people every time I go to a game. It's just my personality type. I try not to be overwhelming because sometimes I'm overwhelming. Sometimes I'm like, hey, you know, and people are like, who the hell is this asshole? You know, so I try not to do that. It's just, it's important to I think for everybody to sort of do that. I mean, Matt, did somebody talk to you first? I mean, who was the first person you spoke to when you joined this whole Groove Machine thing? I mean, somebody had to interact with you.
I saw that you had put out the call for the drummers before the 2016 season.
Right.
So just everybody who showed up to that, I was talking to all of
them. Okay, okay, yeah. Okay.
I started in 2015 over by the first base rail mm-hmm. or foul pole. Mm-hmm. And then saw everybody having fun over in the Cooper section. So I kind of gravitated that way. Mm-hmm.
So it's really important to try and get people to get out of their comfort zone. Mm-hmm. You know, you did it in a very grand way. Mm-hmm. I mean, being like you're saying, so did Wyatt.
Right.
You know, so did Katie. Katie's the same. That's what I'm saying. Everybody we spoke, even Ken to an extent. I mean, Ken's not a super extroverted guy. He isn't. I mean, I've gotten to know him really well. But it's getting people to step a little bit out of their Shauna. I mean, you never struck me as a super.
I'm an introvert.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. So it takes a lot to be able to interact with somebody who is like that to get them to not be like that anymore. You know what I'm saying? Does that make sense what
right.
I just said?
Because there's probably a lot of – because I wanted to capo well before anyone approached me or I got to speak to anyone about it. So there's probably plenty of people that want to join in on this.
Right.
But they sort of need that little push, right? They need to feel accepted, right?
Which now leads me into your, I guess, new role as in the hierarchy of the Coopers. Can you want to talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, I will be president for the remainder of this year. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Sort of like President Brad Estes.
Yeah, sort of.
I ran out.
Damn it, Derrick. I know.
Would you like to lick my dewy?
No, okay. No, I'm good. Maybe okay. It was tequila, but
okay. So you're now the president. You're yes. The acting president. Mm-hmm. Tell us a little bit about what we might be doing the rest of the year.
So we've begun sort of reaching out into Butchertown and talking to businesses about. Sort of partnerships. I really want to get the fan base sort of acclimated to the Butchertown area.
Okay.
Because we're going to be spending a lot of time there.
Mm-hmm.
And the businesses have been really receptive of it because we're going to
bring... Of course they are.
Yeah, we're going to bring 10,000 drunks there.
Right.
And it's just really cool to see what it has already started to do to the neighborhood, right? You've got new businesses sprouting up. Mm-hmm. That probably would not have been there if not for that stadium. It's already paying dividends, right?
There's going to be like an infinite amount of breweries down there.
Yeah. I want to drink at all of them.
Oh, can you give us maybe the format of the – is there a new board? Is that changed at all?
Or? Yes. So we've got – so I'm president. Wyatt has remained. Wyatt Weeks is vice president.
Okay.
Glenn Grum has stepped into the role as treasurer. Anthony Leanhart has stepped into the role as secretary.
Awesome. Yeah. Good for Anthony.
Anthony's a great guy.
He's a good dude. He is.
Everyone else I just named wasn't great people.
Yeah,
Anthony is the best. And our two new at-large members are Justin Mounts and Mr. Matt Owens.
Very good.
The returning, the crafty vet. Justin, returning. Yeah.
The crafty vet. The brains behind
just
the operation.
I thought I was out.
They pull me back in. So, all right, so we got a new board mm-hmm. and wanting to get engaged in the Butchertown area. What about, I know Angel Share has become, has really revved itself up for a while.
It's been amazing.
Okay.
Everyone involved in that just,
my hat to them as well. It's,
Everyone involved in that just pledging their time, volunteering, and everyone who has given money. Mm-hmm. Just thank you so much because this is there's nothing I'm proud of more that we've done this season than Angel Share. The donors also.
Absolutely. To all the donors who have given money.
Absolutely.
Talking about now as a president, interaction with other supporter groups.
How yes. We have been having meetings with Scouse's House.
Yes.
You and I went over to the Scouse's House side. I think me not going over there is why we lost last game.
Yeah.
Because we saw that banger from Hopono.
Man, I was crazy.
From a great view, a fantastic view. Those guys are great. Yeah. They've got a great view in their section. And they're all, we're sort of all, the way I've been framing it is we're sort of we're different armies, but we're marching under the same banner, right?
That's exactly.
Yeah. And it's,
I think of it almost as like Army, Navy, Air Force, different whatevers. You're armed with different cheering gear.
Yeah.
I mean, same, I don't know if that's a very good analogy, but I'll pretend that it's good for a second. And please continue. I'm sorry.
And yeah, we're working on sort of like joint watch parties, joint activities, so we can, so our members can sort of mingle with their members, because we're on opposite sides of the pitch, and I don't think there's necessarily a lot of opportunities.
Right.
But those guys are great. Andy, Evan, to an extent, he's okay.
Evan's great. He's okay. Evan's good.
Scouse is the greatest, obviously.
Yeah. Somebody asked something, because I'm going to try and get Melissa on the phone here.
Ooh.
So please.
Oh, Matt, one thing I wanted to bring up when we were talking about community involvement and getting more people to kind of jump into what we want to do. Because I know that we want our supporter section at the new stadium to be very, you know, movement friendly and, you know, whatever other words you want to stick on it. But LAFC, I like to bring up LAFC because I like what they've done with their standing only room supporter section. I think that it's amazing. They threw a block party and they brought in hundreds of people, crazy people that wanted to go to a block party, and they pulled them in and they kind of, you know, adopted them into their section. That's how they grew their section, was by throwing this huge block party. It was a big community block party. They had vendors there. Right. They had all the different breweries involved. It was like one of those food truck events, only it was, you know, grander scale. But that's how they wrapped everybody in, and it turned it into a community thing, because it's something that, you know, like, you know, different folks want to come in.
Right. And essentially, we'd be continuing the block party every single game. Right?
And you're talking about going down and talking to local businesses and stuff. Like, you know, it's a perfect opportunity. Tell the businesses, like, hey, we want to throw this block party. Yeah, y'all want to get involved in it, and then boom, all the people come.
Right,
you know,
and there's a lot of great restaurants down there.
Yeah,
great breweries.
Yeah,
a lot of great bars.
Yeah,
Odeon hosted us at our board meeting yesterday. Great, great little spot.
That's cool.
Yeah, tremendous building.
Yeah, I wonder how we can include not just the Angel Share stuff, but also upcoming events like that on a weekly basis when we're doing this deal, and we can coordinate, you know, however we have to do that to make sure that we're getting the right information out to everybody. The status of the fundraising status, I have a question about. The fundraising status of the Coopers right now is, what can they do and what they, because people ask me all the time, you know, how do you, if we're going to fundraise, what are we doing? And I'm like, well, there's different statuses. So what can we do from a fundraising standpoint? And what, you know, what are the things that maybe we cannot do? Does that make sense?
In terms of, so we've been
like events, like, I don't think we can run like a poker table. You know what I'm saying?
Right. Yeah. I don't think that's,
you know, but there's groups that do that, you know, and they like, you know, you go to a church thing and there's, they have a license to, at least I hope they have a license to do it. Cause if they don't, oh, I don't, but
it's a charitable gaming license.
Okay. So anyway, go ahead. I'm sorry.
How do we get one of those gaming license things?
They can be expensive.
Well, let's not do that then.
Right.
Anyways. You can just jump through hoops like Derby City Gaming did. She got that.
That's like some Mission Impossible stuff going through those hoops. I don't know what the logic was on that, but
one day.
All right, I'm going to try this. She knows that I'm going to try and call. I hope we'll see what happens. I'm going to try and see what happens. Contacting, ringing. I don't know if she's going to hear this or not. Ring number two. Ring number three. Disappointing. I really miss her.
Potter, 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 Potter.
Nah.
First Sergeant, answer your phone.
Yeah, First Sergeant. Where you at?
Can we tell her to do that? Is that, that's not an order, right?
I just figured, you know, she said that, you know, depending on what her work is.
She's close enough.
But anyway, all right, so we talked about the fundraising. We talked about the new group. We talked about future efforts, open mic, talk about what you want to talk about.
So if you've got ideas, if you've got contacts within the community, if you want to grow this, right? Because if you are a Cooper, if you are a member of the Coopers, this is your supporters group, right? It's not just the people you see on vodcast. It's not just the people you hear on Barrel Proof.
That's correct.
It's not just the people with the flags who are leading marches, right? It's you. You guys are the lifeblood of this whole thing, right? So if you've got any ideas, if you've got things you want to bring that you think can make this better, get in touch with us. The Coopers Louisville at LouisvilleCoopers.com. You can find us on Facebook. I think we have Snapchat. I don't know.
Do we have a Snapchat?
I don't know. I bet that's a dirty Snapchat.
I was going to say. I hope not. I hope we don't.
We have Instagram.
Glory, global city.
Don't you want to be involved in this, people? Don't you want to share this experience with us?
I'm just worried about my neighbors right now.
I am too.
And the purple goes marching. And one more thing.
Oh, boy.
That's awesome. But, man, I hope we will have you on as the new president. Obviously, we're going to stay in touch. We'll have you on periodically. Like I said, we definitely want to do the Angel Share thing as well. And we can coordinate this a little bit more. So all the information gets out. We're all marching in the same direction. I want to thank you personally.
Thank you.
For stepping up and doing this. Because it is not easy. Being the leader of a group like this, it is not. It's not easy to lead it because it's. We go back to the social media nonsense. People will criticize you who won't put the shoes on.
Yeah,
and I that's fine. There's ways to do that. If there's something that I'm doing personally at a game that you don't like, you can approach me however you want to approach me, and I'm going to listen to you. But if you come at me with Dur, you're a big jerk. I'm not listening. Sorry.
Quit beer bombing my kids, Joe.
I apologize for that.
Sort of valid criticism. Okay.
You know, but I did apologize. See, now that you said that, now I'm going to wait. When he's not there, you're getting drenched. Oh my gosh. You're going to drown. You'd be drowning in Bud Light.
Just give me warning so I can be next to him.
But honestly, Matt, you're a great guy. And you've done such great work. It's not just you, though. I mean, you personally, obviously, congratulations on the engagement. Hopefully, we'll be getting some more information on how that all is going to go down.
Mm-hmm. I'm waiting for it too.
Oh my gosh. I didn't mean to start an argument. But whatever we can do to help, we're going to do. And just know that. I mean, I know that we all want, we want everybody to be marching the same direction, but yourself that are willing to step out and take on an extra role need support. So we'll be there for you, Bill.
And thank you guys for doing this, right? Because you saw a thing and you wanted to do it and then you did it.
Right.
That's what all of this is about, right? Angel Share wouldn't have gotten off the ground if not for people just seeing the need for it and then just doing it. It's DIY. It's punk rock.
Right.
It's if you want to do something, do it. If you've got ideas, come to us,
right,
and we will help to facilitate any way we can.
Awesome.
And this is your culture, right? This is your supporters group, so grow it.
Right. Anything else? Mm-mm. Okay, Matt. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Why don't you stick around?
So
you can
much.
Stick around if you'd like. If you want to switch with Matt, we can do our final segment. I'm sure you'd be interested in sticking around. Matt Dalton, ladies and gentlemen, now the president of
camera. I don't know why I'm waving.
The president of the Coopers. He's waving to nobody. That's okay. There it is. We see you now.
That seat is on camera. So
and
leaning all over the.
You know, all the folks that have chosen to be leadership. Matt, I think you got to tip your hat to them because, like I said, it can be really, really thankless. You know what I'm saying?
I know exactly what you're saying.
That's okay, though. Appreciate it. Okay, so the last segment of the show we like to call Rim Shots. And what this basically is that everybody gets a chance to rant a little bit about something. Could be Loucity related or could not be Loucity related, soccer related. So if anybody has something that wants to, Matt, would you like to go ahead? Do you have anything in particular? Could be the last game.
I'm trying to think, how to go with this. Well, I am newly on the board, as we discussed. And just want to say, kind of be patient with us. There's been a lot of turnover. There's been a lot of chaos.
Right.
We're going to be working really hard in the coming weeks and months to get things back to where they should be. Mm-hmm. So, please be patient with us. And if you've got ideas, I mean, keep sending them. If you want to help out, keep reaching out to us because we want everybody involved.
Right. And thank you once again for you personally for doing all the work that you're doing. You're just one of those guys.
One of those guys.
Yep.
You know?
I hadn't built anything in like a month or two and it was driving me crazy.
So getting the itch.
Yeah.
You ready? Derrick, yeah. You got anything?
I had to look something up before I made this statement, but I just wanted to add that I've got two things. The United States men's national indoor team is still undefeated against Mexico.
Nice.
And that makes me very happy. The other thing that I wanted to mention, we kind of touched on it earlier, is the standing room only supporter section. Mm-hmm. I'm overly excited about having this section. What the team did is they went out and they looked at other supporter sections. They went out and they saw the atmosphere. Right. They saw what those people were doing with the sections. And from what I understand, we've got it at both ends. Does Scouse's house have standing room only? Yeah. So we've got this at both ends. There's so much opportunity here to do wild and crazy things. So all it's going to take is for a group to get together, start something, and bam, we've got something that we will always remember. We'll have some originality over there. It's like we just have to get the people to come and do it.
Yeah.
And that'll happen. And what you all are doing with the community and stuff down there, especially in Bushertown and everything, it's going to come together. And I'm looking forward to that. I can't tell you how excited I am for that. And I understand, you know, we've got this we've got the culture here in Louisville where, you know, everybody's been used to going to the U of L football games, and not that that's a bad thing.
Right.
But Louisville has a certain way of attending sporting events. Right. And I know that that's a kind of a weird statement, but you can see it. Like, sure. You can definitely see it. And the more and more people
you know what I think that is, and you can tell me if I'm wrong. I think with the horse racing thing being so important here, wow,
ice maker man.
I think we're just
making some ice.
I think we just lost our atmosphere. I think Louisville's sports culture really is derby. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. And the horse racing culture, you're not there for the first race.
Right.
You're not there for the second race. Right. That's why I think it is what it is. I'm sorry to interrupt you.
Well, no, I mean, it's, you know, the more and more people, like I'm on, I don't want to like plug, you know, what I do for work, but I'm on U of L's campus all day. And, you know, they're like, and, you know, we've all been in promotional material at this point for Louisity. People are like, you're that guy that hits the drum with the beard. I'm like, yeah, that's me. And it happens all the time on U of L because I've got, you know, college students. There's all these college students down there. There's teachers, everything. And they're like, you know, I went to my first Louisity game, man, and it was so much fun. You know, how do I come over to your section? I'm like, just come over there.
Just walk.
Yeah.
Come over and say hello. Come see us at the drum. Come say hi.
And he and Derrick practices what he preaches because you did bring a first-time person to a game last week.
I did.
Not?
Yeah.
Is she here?
She is. She's a beautiful young lady that came to her first game.
Hello. Look at that. Hi. Her name's Hi.
But that's, you know, I see that all the time. I think, and hey, this is something we can talk about later. I could plug some stuff down at the campus at U of L. Like,
yeah.
I need to talk to you because I got an idea. I didn't think you were on campus all the time.
Oh, God. I've been down there for the last 3 months and I'm tired. Like, I'm physically tired.
I need you to make a stop.
Okay. But yeah, I have a lot of outreach when it comes to the university. And so, you know, I've got that, I can stick my hand in there, but, that's a good opportunity there to get some of those guys in. I'd love to get the Luligans down there. I don't know what they're doing now. Sure. or what their status is with our section, but mm-hmm. You know, I love that kind of trade out that we've had lately where we all go to the U of L.
Right.
Yeah. And you know, you've got those kids down there, they've got one drum and, it's kind of an out of tune drum. Right, it's loud as hell. Like,
right. We're going to talk a little bit about that in the future, about how we can personally support college soccer here as the groove machine or as something bigger than that on our own, in our own terms.
And U of L soccer has earned
some support.
Oh, yeah. Presence down there. Yeah, like
right. We tried doing that, Matt, right? You were there a couple of years ago, obviously. Yeah. You know, all the time. And we sort of intermingled with them. Not that we won't do that. But I think we can do something on our own to make it a little bit more extensive than that.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
I don't know.
Definitely.
I don't know about you. I think that boiling point section needs to be more of a focus.
Thank you. That's exactly what it is.
I think we might want to set up camp over there and see if they'll join us.
Exactly. Or see if new people will join us.
I mean, they got the pep band in that one corner, but if we set up like up top or even in the other corner.
Exactly.
It could be a lot of fun.
Good stuff. I mean, that's all I got. I think that I'm... with everything else that I've got going on right now, I'm like, in the back of my head, I'm like, my God, we're going to be in a new stadium here like 6 months.
Right.
And I'm like, man, this is like, it's going to be unbelievable. I'm overwhelmed already at how it's just the gravity of the whole thing. When we walk in there for the first time, like we're going to get emotional.
I'm going to be fat, ugly tears.
Oh man. And this is less than, you know, it was 6-7 months from now, like we're going to go nuts. Right. And
it's going to come so quick.
If only people, a lot of people I wish shared the amount of passion that we have for this.
Right.
And all they got to do is come down for like one game, man. Right. And they'd see it and they'd be able to, you know, kind of participate with us. But that's me. I just, you know.
Okay.
So first opponent I've heard St. Louis and Indy bandied about is the most common. Do you have a preference, one of those two or somebody else?
Give us no.
You want Andy?
No, I don't want either. I want somebody that we're going to utterly destroy.
Oh, okay, all right.
Give us Luton United.
Yeah.
Or I want Hartford to come down here and just get the wrath. Like that's. But, you know, I get it. It'd be great to have some away supporters here.
But definitely, it's the.
We started against St. Louis. I mean, you only get one chance to have your first game in the stadium. Plus, I mean, there's a pretty good chance Sean Reynolds, Gaia Band, Kadeem Dakers might all be there.
Mm-hmm.
So they could be in the opening game for the stadium.
Yeah.
Even though they're on different teams, they contribute.
They're still perfect.
Sure. Even if they're part of the story.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Those are the kind of guys that they could pull the upset.
Yeah.
They could come in. That's their legacy. They come in and.
Mm-hmm.
We left Louisville City a few years ago, and now we're the guys that could ruin their home opener in their new stadium.
They better start thinking about what they're doing with their own team right now.
Oh yeah,
St. Louis has taken a nosedive. Oh. Modern.
They got a couple games in hand though, right?
Yeah, but yeah,
they're four, still, I think.
But they've got like in 12th place.
Yeah, they mm-hmm. really hit it. So I've got. It sounds like a lot, but it really isn't. Four of them. Three of them are not Louisville City related. I don't know if you guys read Zlatan Ibrahimovic had an interview with ESPN.
Sorry.
Mm-hmm. And basically took MLS to task.
Mm-hmm.
Beautiful.
And it was gorgeous because he's sitting here for years. And this is personal. I'm sorry. It's personal vindication. I mean, for years, I've been talking about this league and what they're doing. I'm not talking about whether you like a team or don't like a team. That's on you. And I would never disrespect somebody that does that. And I think it's great that people follow teams, and I'm happy for players that make it like Mark Anthony Kay.
Mm-hmm.
And other guys that will eventually make, you know, and Kyle and Ren Chinzing, right?
Mm-hmm.
But when you have probably the most egotistical player in current soccer in the world come out and say, you know what, I'm your league. It makes people go, whoa. It does. That makes MLS fans go, what? What did he just say?
Mm-hmm.
And when he talked about the playoff system, it's like, why do you guys play all these games? You know, I could take a break for 5 weeks and make the playoffs. Talked about the competition, how the competition isn't the same, how relegation is why people fight for their jobs. So at that moment when he said that, because I've never been a big fan of his, but I like him, you know. But then this land, which leads you to the second thing, I don't know if you guys caught this deal with LAFC where he elbowed this dude.
Oh, God.
I mean, it was a measured, calculated, thuggish slice at this dude.
The guy needs surgery.
Guy needs surgery.
Put a dent in his head.
Right. Put a dent in his head. The guy needs surgery. He didn't get a yellow. And they reviewed the foul, and he's not getting a suspension.
Mm-hmm. He also called LAFC's assistant coach a – it wasn't the word rich.
Right. Which leads me to that second point. MLS has an opportunity. This is how weak they are. You just had a star call you out on ESPN, and then he does something like that, and you let him get away with it. I don't get it.
Can you imagine that happening?
Can you imagine if Cameron Lancaster did that to somebody? He'd get six games.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And so it just speaks to what that league's about for me. I don't get it. Why do he not only did he, like I said, not only did he take them to task at a national interview, he then goes ahead and lays somebody out because I guess he thinks he can, and doesn't get one foul for it. And that's why I don't get it. I mean,
MLS is to soccer what the WWE is to Greco-Roman wrestling.
Yeah, I hear that. That's a good call.
It's soccer entertainment.
It's just heartbreaking.
The only thing they don't do is fix the games.
Right, and the only people they're going to fix it are the people that watch it, and for all the people that watch it. And I don't know. So sorry. I don't mean to be negative. That's just another example. Just another example makes me feel like I'm. You know, it makes you feel like you. Everything that you've been feeling about it all these years is right. You know, Las Vegas is another example of American soccer. You want to talk? Look. They have. I was a big fan of theirs, and I still am to a point because of how they introduced their personality. But they're a bag of crap. The team just can't play, and they've got a star coach with Ronaldo, and they've got they got the llamas, and they got fireworks, and they got all these promotions, and what they got is like 18 points or something like that. But I'm telling you, the next team that gets an invite is going to be them. And that's, and talk about another problem with American soccer. That just shouldn't happen. As wonderful as their personality is, and it is, and there's a couple more that are doing that. Madison's another one that have developed a very unique personality. And it's great to see that. They're not stoic. But man, it just continually gets my goat that you've got teams like ourselves that just continually have fought year after year to be at the top of the table. But because we don't have llamas and Erica Winaldo, I guess we're not going to get a bid or something. I don't know.
It's American soccer where merit doesn't matter.
Right. That's just, anyway. So those are the negative things. Those are two negative things in one positive. But the fourth thing is talking about Louisville City marching forward. I am very, very happy over the last couple of weeks. And you're here. And it's great to see this, to see that people are really literally putting an effort to put anything of the past behind it, whatever it was. I don't know what it was. And try to get this to be what it's supposed to be. And that is a uniting force in the community, regardless of all the other crap, okay, that this is what this is has the potential to turn into. And whatever effort I can do to help that, I hope whatever effort you can, you'll join in with that. So that's all the stuff that I had. Anybody else want to add anything at all? I feel like I brought things down. I apologize. We should talk about dog farts or something.
I like turtles.
Turtles are sexy. I like turtles. Turtles are the best. They got shells.
How about that stadium?
Yeah. Great stadium. So anyway, next week we can announce that we have our guests are already picked. It's very cool. Mm-hmm. Howie Lindsay.
Two
weeks from tonight. So Howie Lindsay has agreed. We talked to him today, and he's going to come on. I think that's pretty awesome.
Heck yeah!
You know, he's an employee now of the team, and he's a pretty big name in the community. We have Glenn coming on. You know, I've decided that Glenn should have his own name like Cher. He should just be Glenn because he has this. He's Glenn.
He's very much a Glenn.
His aura.
Have you managed to get a promise that he will be wearing a shirt?
No. I'm kind of hoping he does it now that you said that. I hope. But Glenn will be here.
Damn it.
Yeah, right. And then our special guest is going to be none other than Michael Bromelow Scouse.
Awesome.
He's coming on here. I love Mike. He's a piece of work, boy. And he's done. You want to talk about a guy that has done a lot of work to help organize a section that helps all of us. And we'll just keep taking it through. We've got a lot of other guests that are going to be coming on. We're practically set for the next three shows. And I don't want to give away anything, but we got some good ones. I mean, there's a couple of really good ones coming up.
That one, you don't have to worry about me.
Not as good as Matt. But who's got something? You got anything you want to finish with?
I'm good.
You're better than good.
I feel good.
You're great. What about you?
Vamos Morados.
Everybody, thank you so much for being a part of this. It's going to take a while, but we're going to build this up, and we got a lot of great plans for it. Thank you so much to everybody that's been on, and I guess we'll see you in 2 weeks. Peace. Yay.
End.